Hello, hello, and welcome once again to a Beatles show that we call Things We Said Today. This is a weekly program in which we focus on the news of the Beatles, and I'm Ken Michaels. Many of you know me for another Beatles show that I host called Every Little Thing, and I'm being joined by my co-host for Things We Said Today, the man who writes for Beatles Examiner, that being, but of course, Steve Marinucci. Hi, Steve.
Hi, Ken. Hello, everyone.
On today's show, we have a very special guest in our studio. Second time he's actually been on our show. It's Charles Rosanay, and many of you know him for so many of the things that he's done in the past connected with the Beatles. And as a matter of fact, in Connecticut, where we're taping this, and where I do my radio show for the last few years, he's organized an event called Danbury Fields Forever, which happens every single year. It's just a lot of local talent, all Beatles tribute bands, and it's a fun thing. He's been a part of Beatle trips to England for a long, long time. How many years, Charles?
31 years.
31. Jeez. It's incredible. And it always happens the end of August. He organized these trips, and they're all wonderful. And he's here to talk about a whole series of events that he has planned in New York City, all coinciding with, well, I don't know if you know this or not, but there is this anniversary coming up. It's called the 50th anniversary of the Beatles' arrival in America. Everybody's hush-hush about this. I don't know what's going on. No one's saying a word.
I have to ask you something.
What's
does
that?
Steve know that when you do your show, you do it wearing basketball shorts and a Sgt. Pepper outfit?
He doesn't know this.
I don't know that. I wish I could see that.
This should be televised for that reason alone.
It should be. I think, we should start televising.
You're giving the game away.
It was 50 years ago, almost today, huh?
Uh-huh.
A few weeks away, when the Beatles arrived in America and when they played the Ed Sullivan Show. And there's so many great things happening to celebrate that. And I'm really proud that I'm involved in some, you know, things that are going on in New York City, which might not otherwise be happening.
Well, you could always celebrate anniversaries on the Beatles and plan events. So, but this is the big one, you know, happening that particular week. And why don't you tell the folks, first of all, it's called, there's a couple of names that you've given me, New York City Fab 50, New York City Beatles 50.
Well, the overview is NYC Fab 50, celebrating the music of the Beatles. And that's what the entire series is called.
Right.
And the genesis of it was, you know, months and months ago, we thought, wow, there's nothing going on in New York. And, of course, there are more things. But when we planned this, we thought, what can we do to make things special and do something a little different than ever been done before? Mm-hmm. And we looked out at what theaters were available, and we found some really historic places where we can stage shows. And what can we do that hasn't been done along these lines? And that's try to get as many artists who are celebrities in their own rights, all-stars, musicians, rock stars, pop stars, soul stars, R&B people, who can do different shows and really bring bring their versions of the Beatles music out there live. And what we did first is we invited 50 bands from 50 countries for the 50th anniversary.
Mm-hmm.
And that would have been called the Across the Universe Music Festival.
Right.
And about a dozen bands are coming over from Japan and from Brazil and from Mexico and Italy and all these great places. And then we got the Apollo Theater, which Paul, of course, did a concert there. But it's one of those theaters that I've always wanted, all my life wanted to go and never have seen a show there. So that,
right,
that was really exciting. And we put together a lineup of amazing soul and jazz and R&B artists performing Beatles.
Right.
And then at Town Hall on the Saturday night, I'm throwing this all out and we can review it where it'll make more sense. We're doing a show called America Celebrates the Beatles. And I try to get kind of my friends who were rock stars to come out, and it's people like Tommy James, Gene Cornish from the Rascals, and a whole ton. I mean, it's a whole all-star lineup of people who might do a song of their own but are going to do Beatles songs too.
Mm-hmm.
And hearing them do the Beatles songs live is just going to be really amazing.
Yeah, well, I like the fact that there's an alternative out there.
Yeah.
For something different. And the way that I kind of I see like an analogy here. You might think this is weird, but this is all how my brain works. But comparing, for example, when Yoko does tribute concerts for John,
mm-hmm,
to something like the concert for George, Yoko always tries to make sure that there's a lot of current artists out there that are covering John's material with a few veterans.
Right.
You know, to show that John is still relevant to the new generation of artists.
Right.
And at the same time, well, comparing that to the concert for George, those were all people that were friends of George, who mm-hmm. everybody associates with George from back in the 60s and 70s. So this is kind of like taking a different approach. I always like when Yoko does those kind of shows because...
they're great.
Yeah, you hear a lot of artists that you may not have heard of otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a cool idea, as well as throwing in a few, you know, veterans. But I like that particular approach. And you're doing something similar here and exposing a lot of artists from, you know, different countries.
Right.
As well as, I'm sure, some American bands too, right?
Well, yeah, yeah. I mean, we even have a few country artists playing who, you know, I never heard of before but have charted and are well known. And I just didn't think it was fair to leave out country just because I don't know the country artists.
Mm-hmm.
So they're part of the America Celebrates the Beatles and were recently added to that show. And what's really exciting, and Steve, I apologize for not letting you say anything because I'm talking so much here.
That's all right.
Is we actually reached out to some bands who were on the verge of committing and couldn't because of other obligations. The Wilco, Flaming Lips, Counting Crows, Gin Blossoms. There was a whole slew. Jim James from my Morning Jacket, mm-hmm. who I don't know that well, but my daughter knows, and you know, they're new generation rockers who wanted to be part of this also. And unfortunately, the timing didn't gel for this event, so maybe in the future we'll do that. But you mentioned the Yoko shows where she brings in new artists. I think about that's the only thing that's really missing here is really cutting edge current artists.
Uh-huh.
But it's certainly, you know, people from 70s, 80s, 90s, back to the 60s who are coming out and doing their hits and the Beatles hits, which makes it really amazing.
You have a couple of people that are making me really wish I was going to be in New York. I'm not going to be, but I really wish I was. One is Melanie, believe it or not.
Yeah.
Who I would really, really love to see. And the other is Lulu. I think, I mean, seeing Lulu would be fantastic. I would love, in fact, I saw her a couple of years ago on the British guy that knows, that has worked with the Beatles, and I can't remember his name off the top of my head. The one that worked with them for the anthology.
You don't mean Jules Holland.
Yes, I do.
Jules.
I do mean Jules. Yeah, Jules Holland. And, yeah, she was on Jules Holland a couple of years ago, and she was absolutely fantastic. She was great. And I would love to, I'd love to see her. I'd also like to ask her about the Bee Gees, too. I mean, oh, God, that's fantastic. But you've got some great tribute bands in there that I have seen before. One of them is Two of Us.
Oh, yeah.
I've seen them before. They are excellent. They are wonderful.
Well, we try to get, you know, the best bands from every country and also throw in a few, I don't want to say novelty, but we have like the Clover, who are a Japanese all-girl band coming mm-hmm. in. We have Dressed to Kiss, who are a Kiss tribute band who dress in Kiss makeup, wear the costumes, but are doing a set of Beatles songs as Kiss would.
That's cool.
Oh, my God.
And we, and, you mentioned Lulu. I just, you know, there's pictures of her with the Beatles, of course, mm-hmm. and she was a friend of the Beatles. But she's a perfect fit for that event because it's called Twist and Shout. You know, this is a fundraiser with Twist and Shout and help fight hunger for the food bank for New York City. So 100% of the net proceeds benefit, you know, a charity. Unlike a lot of the events that are going on in New York, you know, we do this as a charity. It's not a moneymaker for us.
Mm-hmm.
And Lulu makes sense because her first hit was Shout. Mm-hmm. And when the Beatles did it, you know, live, they did her version of it.
Right.
So it there is, you know, it really all comes together and ties in.
And somebody else you got, although she's not really a performer, is Julia Baird. You got Julia Baird in there, which is fantastic.
Yeah, she's one of our hosts Saturday night, John Lennon's sister.
That's right. That's right. That's fantastic that you have her. But there's so many, I mean, there's so many things. I guess from an outsider's point of view, I mean, I'm on the other coast, so I can't see all of what's going on. I mean, how crazy is it in New York right now?
Well, it's snowy. It's not crazy yet. I think when the Super Bowl ends, that whole week of the week of, you know, the anniversary, that's when it's going to be Beatlemania all over again.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be on every news station, and it's going to be every reporter and every news and every newspaper. Yeah, it's going to be big. And hopefully we're right in the eye of the hurricane with all the events.
Charles, I'm going to ask you to give away your age. I mean, were you what's your earliest memory of the Beatles?
My first memory is reading my first article in the Examiner. a Beatles examiner. And since then, I've been hooked on the Beatles. I will tell you, which I didn't in the old days, I will tell you now, my first memory in life, Steve, is actually watching the Beatles on the Ed Sullivan Show. That was my first memory.
Very good.
And there's an 8mm film of me somewhere.
Oh, really?
And I got to find it. And I'll tell you a quick story. When the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame opened, it had a video exhibit, and it called on the world's greatest fans. And it had a Hendrix fan, a Springsteen fan, a Dylan fan, you know, all the really legends. Mm-hmm. And they wanted a Beatles fan, and they came to me, and they did an interview, and I looked silly. I was wearing a Sgt. Pepper outfit and John Lennon glasses. But I spoke rather eloquently, and I gave them this 8mm black and white reel of me with a mandolin, because my grandma had a mandolin, and I'm in front of my old black and white TV in the Bronx, and I'm jumping around with a Beatles wig like a little fat idiot, lip syncing a Beatles song while the Ed Sullivan Show is on.
Wow,
it's amazing that my dad would have filmed that, right?
Yeah.
So I sent it to them, and they got it too late to include in the exhibit. I got it back months later. But I haven't been able to find it. And I really need to find that, because we got to load that on YouTube so people can laugh. But to prove without a doubt that I was, you know, a Beatle fan as a first generation guy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, New York was, I mean, I was there a little while. I wasn't there in 64, but I was there after that.
Mm-hmm.
And New York was just amazing. I mean, there was, you know, there was the rivalry between the radio stations. Obviously, they came, you know, there. I mean, it was insane. It was absolutely insane being in New York at that time.
It was amazing. And you bring up the radio stations, yeah. And I remember, you know, going from one station to another and listening to the Good Guys or Murray mm-hmm. the K or Harry Harrison or mm-hmm. whoever it was, you know, Cousin Brucey, and You would change stations according to who was playing the Beatles. You know, I would stay on the Supremes. I might have stayed on the Four Seasons. There was a few others I'd listen to. But I remember my mom and I would just keep flipping the channel on our AM transistor radio till we found Beatles. And nothing sounded better than She Loves You coming out of an AM transistor radio.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Do you remember the night, and I've asked this question on the show before, do you remember the night that Cousin Brucey broke in with a Beatle interview from the Warwick Hotel? You remember that?
I don't.
I do.
Wow.
I happened to be listening that night, and it was absolutely amazing. It was absolutely amazing.
Are you going to ask that question to every single guest we have now on the show?
Yes, I will.
Well, you'll probably have to ask Cousin Brucey himself if he remembers it.
I would, yeah. Actually, I would love to ask Cousin Brucey.
But I remember New York radio very well. I was not really an MCA fan. I was an ABC guy all the way.
Mm-hmm.
But even though it's several years later, the one very vivid memory I have is when Hey Jude came out, and one radio station would be playing the beginning of the song, and then I would turn to the other station and they'd do the na-nas.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
You know? So it would so much dominate the airwaves when Hey Jude came out.
Did you guys find that one station, that ABC was really the station that everybody preferred, or did you find, were there friends that preferred MCA? In my experience, it was ABC that everybody was listening to.
I think ABC, A Beatles C, mm-hmm. is gonna remain the Beatles station. Mm-hmm. I listened to MCA more.
Did you?
Yeah, and I don't know why, but yeah, maybe because it was closer on the dial. I don't really know why. I remember listening to MCA more than ABC.
They did they did some great stuff. There's an archive online where you can hear a lot of sound clips from those days.
Wow.
And it's the Music Radio 77 website.
Right.
And MCA, not to, you know, to give them a lot of credit, did some wonderful stuff. They had those great sweatshirts. They had, I mean, they just did, I remember some of the stuff that they did, and it was fantastic. And the war between the two of them, I mean, was just fantastic. I mean, it was great for the fans
to be able to hear that stuff. Of all the stations, I like listening to a station called WDHA when Ken Michael had his Beatles show on there. That was the best New York metro station.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Charles. Mm-hmm. Now, those were good times, though. 10 years working there and
Absolutely.
Doing my show.
Oh, my gosh.
And I had almost complete freedom to do whatever I wanted to do.
Which is unheard of
in radio
business,
these days.
Right.
Well, on commercial radio,
on commercial radio.
Yes. But yeah, those were really good times. I still have my old transistor radio, though I never use it. But walking down the street, carrying it, holding it up to my ear.
Of course.
You know, that was the way to hear those hits back then.
Cousin Brucey, we mentioned him, is one of the people on our host committee advisory board. And although he's taken on their other things that he's doing and isn't part of our event, we have other really amazing people on that board who are also going to be hosts and presenters, including Marvin Scott, who interviewed the Beatles when they came off the plane and is now a WPIX senior news person. Dick Cavett, I mean, who of course interviewed George and John and Yoko.
That's incredible. Dick Cavett is fantastic.
We're so glad we've got him. And then other, you know, I don't want to say New York eccentric people, but certainly people, you know, who amazing Kreskin and Charles Grodin, the actor, Len Berman, a New York sports guy. They're all going to be part of this, as is John Lennon's sister Julia, as presenters, as is Ken Michaels, of course.
That's right.
So it's really going to be great not only having all these amazing acts, but also having, you know, great MCs bringing on the acts.
Well, the clincher for me was Julia.
Yeah.
If Julia's an MC, I'm co-MCing with her.
There you go.
But let's talk specifically about the show at the Apollo, because I mean, you just got Dionne Warwick for this show.
Ridiculous,
I mean, she's like one of the absolute legends, you know. And from what I understand, this particular show is a combination of the artist doing Beatles songs, but also doing Motown songs, or maybe R&B songs that the Beatles covered. Correct me.
Okay, so we have three artists who are opening the show: Guitar Charlie, Hal Bruce, and Two of Us.
Uh-huh.
From Manhattan, from Canada, and from Italy, respectively, and they're doing You Really Got a Hold on Me, Please Mr. Postman. They're doing the songs the Beatles did. That's how the show starts.
Okay.
And then we're going to bring on Kitoto Von Hebb, who is Bobby Hebb's daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Bobby Hebb was a friend of the Beatles, toured with the Beatles, sang Sonny.
Right.
And she's going to sing Sonny plus a Beatles song.
Right. And for those that don't know, Bobby passed away a couple
That's
years
right,
ago.
That's right. Right. So she's, you know, going to be there in place of her late father. And we're bringing out Margaret Ross Harris from the Cookies.
Wow.
Of course, the Beatles sang Chains.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And she's
going to
do. And she's going to do that. And then Barbara Harris from the Toys, who's going to do a Beatles song and then do her hit, A Lover's Concerto.
Okay. I remember that song. That was such a great song on the radio.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's just, it gets better. I mean, if that's possible, Gary U.S. Bonds, who toured with the Beatles, is going to do a Beatles song plus one of his hits. Betty LaVette, who's just an unbelievable soul songstress and has done
and who just sang on that Ringo tribute Monday in Hollywood.
Just now.
The other day.
Yep, she's going to be doing two of her two Beatles songs in her style. Lloyd Price, who he's a legend, Lordie Miss Claudie, which Elvis sang and Lennon sang, and he's going to be there doing his things.
Paul did it.
And Paul did it, of course.
Paul did it on the Russian album.
And Elvis Costello did it.
And there's Just Because.
Which, right, he did that,
John
and Personality.
Did yeah.
John did Just Because, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, I mean, they all have, you know, six degrees of separation to the Beatles, but are stars in their own right. And then you're looking at the three headliners: Mary Wilson of the Supremes, always a friend of the Beatles, and she's going to be doing Beatles songs for this. Lulu, who was a friend of the Beatles and is going to be doing Shout. And then Dionne Warwick. It's just, it takes my breath away thinking that we were able to get such famous and such wonderful, illustrious Dionne Warwick. How many Grammys has she won and awards and everything else? But with her, when she heard it was a charity, you know, there was no hesitation. She really, you know, she jumped to be part of it.
Mary Wilson, the Supremes put out that great Beatles cover album. Well, it wasn't all Beatles cover. It was, I mean,
all Mersey stuff.
All Mersey stuff, yeah, in 64. Great album. The Supremes put out that was a wonderful album. Dave Clark 5 is on there and stuff and everything. Yeah,
can I give you guys an exclusive right here, right now?
Oh, go.
The MC for that show?
Mm-hmm.
Actor Danny Aiello.
Nice.
Yeah, so that's awesome. Really exciting. And he has I believe he's bringing along a rap artist who does a version of Let It Be. So another special treat. The show just doesn't, you know, it just gets better and better. It's at the Apollo Theater, and that's Thursday night, February 6th.
Okay.
And the best place to, like, look up all the information on all these events is at NYC Fab 50, which is NYCFab50.com.
Now, who's the backup band for all these artists?
For the Apollo Show, it's really a seasoned group of amazing musicians that was put together by producer Dennis D'Amico. It's Roger Kellaway, who has done an album of Paul McCartney songs and jazz. He's, he's a multi-award winning guy.
Yeah.
And Frankie Previtt, who... I don't know if you remember, there was a band called Frankie and the Knockouts, but that's not what you know Frankie from. You know Frankie because he wrote I've Had the Time of My Life, and he's, you know, won Grammys for Dirty Dancing and all that stuff. So it's really master class of pedigree for,
wow.
for
hey,
musicians.
Frankie and the Knockouts had a great hit.
They sure did.
With Sweetheart.
See, now you would know that because, you know, that's your generation of music, too.
Well, I got a lot of different decades that are part of you know... what's in my heart.
Yeah, so Frankie Previtt is the musical director, and he's put together just the most amazing band that's comprised of soul and R&B and jazz and rock and pop guys with backup singers, and it's just going to be an amazing show. And charity, and it's going to make a lot of money for charity.
Dennis
and
D'Amico.
You're doing it in the iconic Apollo Theater. I mean, just walking in there just must, you know, floor you with the idea of all the people who have played there. I mean, the James Brown Live at the Apollo.
Everyone. You name it. James Brown and Stevie Wonder and the Everly Brothers, Buddy Holly. I mean, the history behind the Apollo, until Paul played it, no Beatle had ever played it, but...
Mm-hmm.
We're proud that we're the second Beatles event to ever be in there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And again, all the money from net proceeds from the ticket sales go to the Food Bank for New York City.
Yeah, Dennis D'Amico, I just wanted to mention, is someone that I became acquainted with back in the DHA days in New Jersey, because he was behind the whole Garland for Linda.
Correct, and he's produced two albums,
right?
Charity albums for Linda and Paul.
Yeah, they're all cover versions of Paul songs, and all the money goes to
the Garland
breast cancer awareness.
That's right, that's right, and that's all under Paul's auspices. I mean, those are authorized by McCartney himself.
Right.
Who we're hoping are going to visit at least one or two of our events, seeing that, you know, they're going to be in the city.
Mm. That would be nice. Actually, it's now occurring to me. Those two albums we were just talking about?
Yes.
I think they're called Let Us In.
Let Us In, and then the second one has a different name, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. One of them was all country artists.
Correct.
Okay, yeah.
And I think two of those country artists, I think, are with us at the Town Hall show, but I'm not sure.
Okay, very nice.
You've got a great lineup at the Town Hall.
I know. It's really unbelievable. If I can say it real quickly, Tommy James, who, what's his Beatle connection, aside from being a great Beatles fan and an amazing, hit maker in his own right, George Harrison loved Tommy James.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to tell this story, are you?
I have to. He gave him two songs to record, which to this date Tommy never recorded because Tommy felt were too close to Hanky Panky-ish, and he was beyond that. You know, he was into Crimson and Clover and Crystal Blue Persuasion and Sweet Cherry Wine and Tighter and Tighter, and was progressing, and he didn't want to, I don't think he wanted to record those songs, but I think someday it's still going to happen.
But you know,
chance he might play one?
I've heard Tommy tell the story many times. He told it to me in one interview that I did with him.
Right, right.
Why can't he produce those songs?
He will.
It's so many years later.
I'll tell you, he's one of these Renaissance men. He's written books, Tommy James. He still writes music. There's either a play or a film coming out on his book.
Right.
So
it's an amazing story,
story. Oh, it sure is.
You know, to be on Roulette Records with Morris Levy and to go through that whole experience.
Right.
There's a connection between Tommy James and the Beatles as Morris Levy with John.
Roulette Records, that's right.
Right.
More of those degrees of separation.
Yeah.
And Melanie, you know, all those hits of Brand New Key and Lay Down Candles in the Rain. You know, what a great voice. It was pretty much the queen of Woodstock, if you think about it.
Mm-hmm.
And she, of course, appeared on stage with John Lennon at the One-to-One concert, and she's coming in. Marshall Crenshaw had his own hit, Someday, Someway, you know, very, very respected New York musician, who one of his early starts was playing Lennon in Beatlemania and playing Buddy Holly in La Bamba.
And that Marshall Crenshaw album was fantastic.
Great album.
It was a fantastic album.
And there's Walter Egan, who one of his favorite things to tell is that he saw the Beatles at Carnegie Hall in '64.
Wow.
He's played with people who played with the Beatles, had a hit with Magnet and Steel.
That's right.
I know you know that one, Ken. And he's coming in to do a few Beatles songs. Fred Schneider of the B-52s. Come on. I mean, him alone, how could be more fun than him coming up? And he hasn't told us what he's going to do. I'm hoping it's going to be like Octopus's Garden or something just off the wall, maybe All Together Now.
And John Lennon, doing John Yoko song. Lennon cited the B-52s, you know, as a parallel to Yoko, what
yes.
Yoko was doing, you know.
He always compliment. He always loved the B-52s.
Right. Mm.
Joining him is a guy named Richard Barone, who I don't think is even on our list. Richard Barone was the lead singer of the Bongos, a big New York band at the time, and he's going to be performing with Fred Schneider and doing a song of his own. We've got Gene Cornish from the Rascals, Rock and Roll Hall of Famer.
Mm-hmm.
Ron Dante, who was the voice of the Archies, who's going to do Sugar Sugar.
You got to tell that connection, that Gene Cornish Beatle connection.
Well, you tell us. It's 1964.
He recorded a Beatle tribute song.
He recorded a Beatles tribute song.
I don't think I remember that. I mean, I couldn't, when I saw that in the press release, I went, really? And I looked it up, and there it is.
I want to be a Beatle.
Right. Oh, my God.
Well, there's other connections, of course, you know, through Sid Bernstein, who managed the Rascals early on, and at the Beatles Shea concert, they flashed "The Rascals Are Coming," which I think upset Brian Epstein. But you know, the Rascals were always big Beatle fans, and Gene Cornish is such a huge Beatles fan. He jumped at the opportunity to be this. Ron Dante is going to do a Beatles song, and we've got our friend Gary DiCarlo, who was famous for the band Steam, had the hit "Na Na Hey Hey Kiss 'Em Goodbye,"
right?
Which of course, I don't know if this is a positive thing, but it's a Beatle thing. It knocked "Come Together" in something out of first place.
Mm-hmm.
It
so
was
we,
the song.
We should boo him.
That, no, no, gosh, no.
I wonder if he's going to dare say that. Well, he probably will. I mean, what's going to happen when he says that at the show? That's going to be funny.
We won't let him say it. We'll let the announcer who brings him on say it.
Oh,
okay.
Ian Lloyd from the Stories, you know, Brother Louie.
Yep.
He's going to be there. John Ford from the Straubs. Randy Jackson, who you only know if you're a Long Island person or if you're from New Orleans, where the group Zebra was unbelievably huge.
I saw them on Long Island when I was in college.
They're a hard rock hair band, right?
Yeah, a lot of people thought that they sounded quite a bit like Led
Zeppelin.
Yeah,
I knew you were going to say,
Robert
yeah.
Robert Plant voice. And as a matter of fact, I just recently played them on my show because they did a John Lennon tribute song called Lullaby.
Wow.
Which is on their No Telling Lies album.
Siobhan Magnus, who was an American Idol finalist, who really shined the night they did that first Beatles, all Beatles show.
Mm-hmm.
And she did, I think, Across the Universe. She's doing that acoustic, and then she's doing Helter Skelter. And it just goes on and on. You know, the music director for the event is Rich Pagano, who people know from Fab Four. Exactly.
Mm.
And he's put together his own little all-star lineup of amazing New York musicians who are going to just back up these people. And between now and then, we might add another surprise or two to Town Hall for Saturday, February 8th, and the show we're calling America Celebrates the Beatles All-Star Concert.
So it sounds like a lot of fun. So Town Hall thing, is it starts what time?
That's at 7:30 on the Saturday night.
Okay, so that's going to go on all through the night,
practically. Probably till midnight, yeah.
Yeah, oh, wow.
If we can fit everything in. Now, that night, we've also having the Cavern Club Beatles playing there.
Okay.
So they moved over from the Hudson there because there really wasn't a Beatles, I don't want to call them suits and boots band, but
right.
You know, a band that wears the wigs and is the exact, you know, clone band that does all mm-hmm. the note for note. So Cavern Club Beatles are actually going to play that night as part of the All-Star Concert. They're really the only Beatles band that are going to be doing that. And they're from Liverpool. They're the resident band of the Cavern Club. And the guys were pulled away from the Cavern Club because they were on in New York on stage and Broadway for the show Let It Be.
Okay.
So this is a little bit of a return to New York for those guys who just, you know, are probably one of the best Beatle bands in the world, and they're
okay.
going to be there Saturday night with all these famous stars that are joining them.
Okay, so if you're looking for something different to do in New York City that weekend, actually it's February 6th.
Or in addition, you can do the other things and also do this.
That's okay. Right.
So wait a minute, the Apollo is on the 6th.
Right.
And Town Hall is the 8th.
And we haven't even talked about the 7th. Do we have time?
Sure, go ahead.
Spin Doctors.
Okay.
One of my favorite bands from the 90s. Two Princes, Little Miss Don't Be Wrong. Was that what was the song? And Jimmy Olsen's Blues from the album Pocketful of Dynamite.
Uh-huh.
They're headlining. with doing all the all Beatles songs plus the few hits, along with a group called Club Big Beatles from Brazil. If you've ever been on any of our Liverpool tours, they're the highlight every year of Liverpool's Beatle Week. And then there's Help from Mexico, Blurred Vision from Canada, with the Williamsburg Salsa Orchestra from Brooklyn, and a surprise act. So that's at the Hudson Theater, which is where the first Tonight Show ever was. Elvis played on that stage, and that's in between. That's on the Friday, which is the anniversary of the Beatles' arrival in America.
Okay.
So it's three amazing special events, with the Apollo on Thursday, the Across the Universe Music Festival at the Hudson on Friday, and the Town Hall All-Star Concert on Saturday.
So that's a good thing, because you're so much on top of bands from around the world going to the Beatles conventions in Liverpool.
Yes.
As well as the local talent when you do the thing in Connecticut,
yeah,
at Danbury Field. So you're very much aware of some of the best bands around the globe. So this is just a little sample of that in this one show.
Right. I'm privy every summer when we bring our fans, you know, we bring groups to London and Liverpool on our Magical History Tour, which is at liverpooltours.com. Whenever we do that, I get to see hundreds of bands, you know, from every country and every style, you know. And we kind of invited the best of them. And the ones that were in a position to come over from New York and, you know, be part of this, are pretty much the ones who go to Liverpool every summer and are the most popular. And for example, the group Two of Us from Italy, when they announced it, it made the cover of the Italian national newspaper.
Oh my.
So it's really special, yeah, for us having them, but it's also special for the artists to be able to be part of this event.
Right. To show how important this anniversary means to them.
To them and to, certainly to Americans and New Yorkers and everyone, you know, who's listening to the show, sure.
Yeah, and it also shows how universal the Beatles are, as if we need to know. It's a fun thing when you go to the Liverpool convention, when you see all these different bands, and some of them may not really know English.
And some of them can't speak a word of English.
And
you're absolutely right.
They pronounce everything phonetically, and they may not even know what they're saying or singing.
A lot of the bands actually learned how to speak English from Beatle records.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
The Russian bands always tell us that. If it had not been for Beatle records, they would not have been exposed to Western civilization.
Amazing.
And had they not sneaked into, you know, in the Beatle records into their country, you know, under you know, underground means, that they wouldn't have ever known any English, and they wouldn't have been exposed to anything Western if it wasn't for the Beatles.
That's just amazing to know. how much an influence the Beatles have had in so many different ways around the world.
On so many levels, musically, socially, you know.
And the thing, you know, and people have been starting to talk about it as the anniversary approaches, but it's really true that you couldn't repeat what happened in 64 now.
Of course not.
I mean, there's big acts now, but they're big for different reasons. The Beatles was all homegrown. I mean, that developed, that was truly word of mouth. It was amazing what happened.
I think a lot of it just has to do with the media and the way that it's set up.
Well, yeah, that's the whole situation. It's a whole different culture now than it was in 64.
Oh, Steve, the stars aligned perfectly. You know, people talk about America losing, you know, President Kennedy, and I understand, you know, that was probably had something to do with it. But is there anything more perfect than Paul on the left with the, you know, bass guitar facing one way, George in the middle with his little dance, John with his, you know, sneering, smiling, great rock and roll voice, and Ringo shaking his head? It was perfection. Oh, my God. I just, you know, people said to me, the other day they said, you know, the Beatles are overrated. And I said, stop. They're still underrated. They're still the most underrated, perfect musical entity that ever existed.
When you sat there and watched them in 64, you just couldn't help but be taken by the whole thing. I mean, to watch them, you know, do what they were doing, to watch the four personalities who really, when the Ed Sullivan Show came on, we were just starting to get to know, because they actually, you know, told people who was who.
Right.
It was just an amazing situation, and, you know, coupled with what was happening on the radio, not just in New York, but everywhere. I mean, it was amazing. It was absolutely astounding.
I'm not ashamed to say I fell in love with them, and I never fell out of love with them.
Yeah,
we all feel that way.
Yeah,
I think that's about true for everybody.
Well, if you were a boy, I think you wanted to be a Beatle.
Right.
And if you were a girl, you wanted to marry or sleep with a Beatle.
Right.
And none of that could happen. But I think the three of us and a lot of people out there, you know, this is how you either become a collector or you listen to it or you become a producer or do a radio show. I mean, we're living our dreams, you know, in many ways thanks to the Beatles.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I mean, how many boys wanted to be one of those guys on that stage?
Of course.
You know, I mean, and who did you imagine yourself to be?
Paul.
Yeah, I think a lot of us did, you know, imagine that we were Paul. But I mean, I did my share of singing along to Beatle records and pretending I was John after watching the cartoons and the way they had him, standing there. I mean, I did that. You know, I did that too, and I think a lot of us did.
Yes.
You know?
Well, I think one of the secret elements of the success of the Beatles is that I think there's one of them that all of us can more closely identify with. Mm. You can love all four of them, but you might say, well, I'm most like this one. You know, and as a matter of fact, I think we've all seen it. I've seen it recently on Facebook. They do a little survey. Which one of the Beatles are you most like? You know, and then they do this little survey, and based on that, they determine whether you're more like John or Paul. You know,
that's funny. It's true.
But you know, we can all feel close to, or at least identify very closely with one of the four of them, and still love all of them for different reasons.
Capitol did that. That's the genius of the whole Beatle marketing thing. They knew they had four personalities, and that may explain the whole Pete Best thing, why Pete didn't work and Ringo did.
I was just going to say, you know, I love Pete, and he's probably my favorite because we're friends, but that doesn't count. But you're right. Ringo was the character that the media was able to latch onto.
Mm-hmm.
He was funnier. And, you know, as much as I love Pete, and it's sad, and he was probably the unluckiest person on earth, Ringo was perfect for hitting America and making them as famous as they were.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a great drummer by then, even.
Yeah.
And he was really well-known in Liverpool, when he was getting other offers besides the Beatles, which people don't even realize. And Mark Lewisohn even brings it up. Yeah, but I'm saying, you know, he was in demand.
Yeah.
You know, and people don't give him enough credit. He was a great drummer even early on, and he became extremely innovative later on, and still was great even on those early records.
All right, we'll let him play if he comes to one of these shows. You talked me into it.
Twist his arm.
Twist and shout.
Yeah. All right, so if people want to know more about this, more than what you've already said,
the best place is to go right to the website, www.nycfab50.com, and it's nycfab50.com. And you can get tickets, of course, you know, through Ticketmaster and all the regular ways. But we hope people come out, and I'll be at the door at the end of the show, so if you have a good time, you know, say hello on the way out.
You can see Charles. You can see me at Town Hall.
Right.
So
we got to fly Steve in. Steve, you want to come?
Oh, do I want to come? Do I want to come?
Charles just told me he has this single engine plane that he has reserved just for you.
You mean he'll come and pick me up at my house?
Only if you wear the basketball shorts and the Sergeant Pepper outfit like Ken is.
That's my forte.
All right, sorry.
I dress to kill here when I do this show.
Dress to Kiss is the name of the Kiss band coming.
There we go.
All right, Charles, thanks so much for being here, and we look forward to NYC Fab 50. Did I get that right?
Correct. NYCFab50.com.
Thanks for being here, and
thank you, Charles.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah. Four things we said today. I'm Ken Michaels, thanking Charles Rosenay for joining us, and hopefully we'll see you at NYC Fab 50, and I'll see you next time right here.
And this is Steve Marinucci saying thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.